And the three men I admire most, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. They caught the last train for the coast. They the music died. I'm thinking about singing that. Many of us recognize those words from Don McLean's song, American Pie. Maybe one of the more familiar uses of the doctrine of the Trinity in popular culture. I love the song, and I've always loved that line. His idea about the Trinity doesn't pass muster theologically, but I like his musing anyway. The idea that the Trinity, one God, is relating to the world, actually in it, interested in what happens here. That part, I believe, is true and good. It is indeed going to sound cliche, but today's readings for this Trinity Sunday are all about relationship and community, and the fact that our faith and our lives in God are not calls to live alone. Christianity is, as Archbishop Desmond Tutu likes to say all the time, not a solitary activity. As he would put it, a solitary Christian is an oxymoron. There can be no such thing. I guess, forced to it, left on a desert island or lost in the desert, one is still a Christian, and there you can certainly pay homage to God. What is also quite certain is that even there, God will be with you, whether you're alone amidst a million people or truly alone, God is just as present. That is an amazing promise of our faith. But Christianity is, in fact, a faith of practice, not simply of being. And this, to me, is very much related to the doctrine of the Trinity, the theological concept and belief that is honored on this day, this Sunday, also most notable for preachers wishing to avoid it. I used to quite often, as a rector, invite guest preachers and simply give them the date and get it all worked out and then let them discover along the way what I had done. If you haven't noticed, Rachel has done that today. Although I suspect, knowing her, she loves this topic, but many a preacher dreads the day. But truth be told, I'm less daunted by it all now. I'm getting to the age where the explanation, well, it's a holy mystery, is enough for me. I'm okay with somehow believing something and not knowing why. Some would say this is a sign I'm finally entering into the second half of my life, or as some might put it, the downhill side, the breezy side of the hills, a good friend of mine used to call it. Maybe so. But we don't have to understand it. Our presiding bishop is famous for saying, you do not have to understand someone or something to love them. He says, for instance, I love my wife. Henry Adams once said, I'll tell you the solemn truth of the doctrine of the Trinity is not so difficult to accept for a working proposition as any one of the axioms of physics. We put our faith in lots of things we don't understand. We still, occasionally, drop a letter in a box, and we expect it to go where we told it to go, and it goes. Most of the time, always, it goes. We have faith in that. Still, we are an enlightened people living in an enlightened age, and the word enlightened puts off many a positive vibe, but in this sense, I don't think it's always a positive. Being an enlightened people can also make one a myopic people, blind to the mystery, lost in the particular, mesmerized in the land of proof instead of feeling. Like all things, being enlightened has a dark side too. The idea of the Trinity excites me more now than ever before. I like the idea that we have a God who is a relationship within itself. Some say a multiple personality God, which is often seen as bad, but in some sense we all have that. Just think about it. We all have our outward selves, our inner selves, the self we share with a very small group of people, and the blind self that we don't even know for ourselves. We have all of that in ourselves. One of my favorite theologians, Miroslav Volf, says, because the Christian God is not a lonely God, but rather a communion of three persons, faith leads human beings into the divine communion. One cannot, however, have a self-enclosed communion with the triune God, a foursome, as it were, for the Christian God is not a private deity. Communion with this God is at once also communion with those others who have entrusted themselves in faith to that same God. Hence, one and the same act of faith places a person into a new relationship both with God and with all others who stand in communion with God. His way of saying it's a relationship. We have a God in a relationship that one can only interact with in a way as to interact with all others who also do it. In effect, we're all in this together. It's a good thing to me that our God is a relational God. Our God is a God where relationship is foundational. Our God has directionality, you might say. God's not just a being without feeling or concern. We use terms for God like immovable, unchangeable, omnipotent. But those are not things I really need from God. And I don't believe those things generally can be part of any being that loves. If you love, if you have the ability to love, you will have to also have the ability to change. If you love, you have to feel. Feelings change us, morph us into new thoughts, actions make us new. I don't know about you, but when I see God, whatever and however that is, I'm not going to be the least bit discouraged if God reveals to me that the concept of the Trinity was a misguided mistake, a fabricated conundrum we humans dreamt up. I'll still be glad to be with a God that loves. Equally, I will be just as fine if we all got it right. Like so many of the concepts and attributes of God that has been important to later Christians, and especially the church, what is most important is the life of Jesus. As Karen Armstrong says, Jesus did not spend a great deal of time discoursing about the Trinity or original sin or the Incarnation, which has preoccupied later Christians. He went around doing good and being compassionate. In short, he practiced love. When John tells us God so loved the world, he tells us that so that we might love God, the world, and all those in it the same way. This is exactly why our presiding bishop's sermon at the royal wedding, which broke every rule in the royal customary weddings, would be one of the most remembered ones ever. Because it was about this very thing, the power of love, and the fact that Jesus came to teach that, reveal that, live that, model that, and calls us to that. And that love, more often than not, will fly in the face of many of the rules that the world has about how we all should relate to one another, live with one another, or go about life on a daily basis. God's kingdom is not this one. As much as we might want to equate it, and no matter how many times anyone names it as such, that kingdom has not come. And we have a long way to get to it. But it is what this, all of this, what we do today and every Sunday, and why we try to follow the way of Christianity, is all about. Or it's about nothing. It is about working even now within ourselves, but even more importantly with one another, to bring that kingdom closer to reality. We know from Jesus' very life this can be a very dangerous thing, but that does not take away from his call on us. In fact, should strengthen. We will witness today the very change of the body of Christ when several among you will step forward to be confirmed and received. We actually believe in the power of our sacramental life. And when we enact these things, confirmation, baptism, marriage, ordination, we change the body of Christ, not just the person. Like that mysterious, indescribable, hard to understand concept of the Trinity, the larger body of which we make up, along with millions of Christians around the world, most we will never know, changes today, morphs into something more, something different. Paul and Jesus believe that body gets better every time that happens. The person is not only changed, but we each are changed. And we all together are changed. Can we see that? No. Can we prove it by running a few tests? No. Do we believe it anyway? Well, that's up to you. I do. That sounds a lot like trying to understand the Trinity. I don't understand it, but I believe it. That's what faith is all about. I believe in many things I cannot see and cannot prove, but I know them to be true. I believe in a God that's not just one being, but is in itself a relationship. And in that relationship, we are all included. I believe in a God that is in everything we see and know, and is in between everything we see and know just as much. As Anne Lamott once said, I didn't need to understand the hypostatic unity of the Trinity. I just needed to turn my life over to whoever it was that came up with the redwood trees. For 125 years, those who preceded you in this place, named for the Trinity, have been doing their best to live into that holy mystery. I did not live with all of them, as most of you did not, but I've lived amongst many of you now for about 11 of those years, and I can say I don't find you all to be a people hung up on whether the doctrine of the Trinity is absolutely true, or having the need to spend lots of energy defending it. I'm glad about that. I would urge you, please keep it that way. Be happy instead that we have a God that loves and asks us to do the same. Ask us to show that love to the world, to be that love in the world. The Holy Trinity will take care of itself. And I truly believe if the world sees and feels and knows that love emanating from you and from this place, those that follow you shall surely be gathered here or somewhere 125 years from now. No closer to solving this doctrine of the church you're named for. But rock solid, assured of what they're calling the world is, to try our best to love in this world in the same way God loves us. That's what the Trinity is about. Don't make it complicated. My sisters and brothers, I've said these words to you in the name of the Trinity, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.